chest you have prepared with your shoulder, arms, elbows, etc. Similarly, when this progresses, then we say release the hands down. Then she takes the hands back and she does namaskar at the back of mind. And the hand rotates, the wrist rotates and the fingers go upward, the elbows go back, she opens the armpit chest. And that's how the shoulder work is introduced in this pose from Parshvottanasana. Now let us see the next poses. In this forward extension in standing poses, you are asked to make first the back concave so that from sacrum region to the cervical, you elongate your whole spine and then you begin. So I ask, may you have to do Parshvottanasana, jump and spread, all of you. Prasadita Parshvottanasana, jump. The others, Uttanasana. Who is going to do Uttanasana? Be ready. With spreaded legs. Pada Mushtasana. Be ready. And who is going to do Adhokushmanasana? Yes, be ready. Now watch. In this Parshvottanasana, suppose if they can't turn the pelvic, their hands are on the waist, they turn from the left pelvic to the right pelvic, then she stretches her arms upward. You find this rotation, you got the arm extension, then exhale and with the hands down, with concave back, she reaches the floor, but she reaches the floor, but head is up, the trunk is extended. Similarly, in Prasadita, you find Devaki is doing with concave back. There you find Rajalakshmi holding her toes and then extending the trunk forward with concavity. And Vijay is doing Adhokushmanasana, where the back is elongated, spine is elongated, and Abhay is doing just with folded arm, head down, so that he recovers from the, this is the pose where one recovers from the fatigue. The stress is given more on the concave back first. Elongating the spine, now they will be exhale and go to the pose with the head up. How are you doing? Now, this is how they rest their head so that in resting position, they find the breath also coming back to normal and recovering from the fatigue. As far as Uttanasana is concerned, Abhay is doing with spreaded legs for a beginner because they are asked to spread the legs. In case they get backache, then we say spread a little more apart and then they can arms down so that they just learn to bend themselves down without straining. Next action is to keep the arms downward, and then when the arms are down, he makes the back concave by raising the head upward. Open the armpit chest, and this extension when it's given with the exhalation, then he goes down with the head down, further descending. And when this action comes better, then he brings his feet closer, joins his feet finally, again makes his back concave. That's intermediate state. Those who have slip disc, those who have back problems, they are not allowed to bend straight away down since they may compress their spine somewhere. In order to remove that compression, we first ask them to get this extension upward and concavity of the spine, and then they take the head down. Now once again, make your back concave, all of you. You change your side on the other side. This group of standing poses belong to the forward extension of the spine. And these asanas remove the fatigue caused by other standing asanas. In all these poses, the spine is up and the heart is below. Now go to the final pose. You see the spine is up and the heart is underneath that. Again, the heart is gravitating in a prone position. Since the head is down, you find it's other way gravitation. And this is a kind of resting position for the heart. Then you just stand up, all of you just stand up and again go to the pose. When you stand up in this vertical position, you find, join the feet, join the toes, stand straight. When you stand, the spine is erect and heart is just in front of it. This is this vertical position. So the pressure, when you stand like this, the pressure on this upright position, you find coming more on the ventricle, that is part of the heart. That's why a heart patient is not made to stand. After few weeks when he recovers, doctor give the permission and they say, all right, now you can stand. So in this vertical position, they find the strain coming on the ventricle. And that's how the enlargement of the ventricle region is faster because it gravitates, it goes down. Whereas in this position, now do the pose, your respective poses. In these poses you find, when the head goes down, The ventricle is facing upward and auricle is down, that means heart itself is going in an inverted position and it reduces the strain on the heart, and that's how you find that after standing poses you recover fast in these poses. That is really when you work hard in standing poses, you feel like doing Uttanasana. You feel like your body craves for Adho Mukha Svanasana, Uttanasana, Rasayaka Padottanasana, so that you can be in a restful state. You know, but I must say that heart position, as I said, in upright position, it's in a state position where the ventricle is gravitating. You know, the pillars, like Patanjali, you see, the platform is given. That's called pitha. The pitha is given for the idol to stand in a proper position. In the similar manner, when you are bending downwards, for this heart, which is in inverted position, you find a proper platform getting formed. And that's how they bring the heart to the restful state. So in all these asanas, the tension on the heart is lesser. So first of all, remember that, since even for the heart patient, these asanas are introduced. Only they may do with the rope or with the stool, using the stool, resting their head on some bolster, brick, etc. That's all the adjustment of the physical body. But otherwise the poses are same. So one recovers from this physical and mental fatigue, strain on the heart, and from breathlessness too. These asanas tone the nervous system, improve the blood circulation towards the brain, and at the same time check the rush of the blood towards the brain. Therefore, one feels cool in the brain, and those who suffer from the high blood pressure, palpitation, depression, swinging moods will find great relief. When you feel nauseated, giddy, blacked out, then switch over to these asanas. And in these asanas, the abdominal organs are massaged. I spoke about the heart. Now I'm getting out the abdomen. The digestion is improved. You can do other side. The excretion becomes easier. That means your peristaltic movement improves. People who suffer with constipation, etc., they find a great relief. They tone liver, spleen, pancreas, and one feels light in the body after doing these asanas. Because you might be questioning some of your teachers are what to do when you are feeling nausea, etc. So these are the poses which are very good. And these various movements, what you saw, now come up, sat in Samasthiti. You saw in Parshvottanasana, the hand movement, which are pelvic movement when she rotated from this end to that end, the legs, the hips, the neck, wrist, everything moves, or the movement is more created there. In these postures, one can derive the effective feeling of Kapi Uttanasana, all of you know. Since head is down, all of you in Uttanasana. No, feet together. Head down. You know, this is what it is, it's kind of variation of Uttanasana. So in this, when you find the head is down, but it is up. In Prasarita also it was the same, Parshvottanasana was the same, Adho Mukha Svanasana was the same, where head was down. One can derive the effective feeling of Sheeshasana by doing all those postures what you saw. These asanas lay a good foundation for Sheeshasana. Since one gets used to the inverted position. Do you see the inverted position? At least from buttock to the head, they are in an inverted state. What happens, beginners, when they have to do Sheeshasana, the inverted moment they have to go to the inverted position, the fear complex is there. Or they are not used to the inverted view. Now, for example, turn that way, the back to the wall, the other way turn, the head down. Now when they are looking at you, spread your legs apart, head down, or do your own poses, Prasayita Padottanasana, Adho Mukha Svanasana, there itself. This way, facing this way, yeah. As you find, their head is down, for them, you are looking in an inverted state. You understand? But you are sitting in this posture, for them, your legs, when you are sitting like that, for them it's an inverted vision. And in Sheeshasana, that's what happens when you do as a beginner, you don't know where the floor is and where the ceiling is. And that's how the nervousness comes. And these are the postures when you do in a proper way, you get used to this inverted view. Inverted view and inverted your own body position, etc. And that's how these postures are good. Sort of proper base for your Sheeshasana, since they reduce their fear complex and prepare one physiologically and psychologically. Because because as you have heard that people, those who suffer with blood pressure, doctors say don't do shirshasana. But these are the poses which will bring the blood pressure to normal and then one can do shirshasana. And that's how they have good foundation for shirshasana or any other equipment. Now come up. Stand up. Samasthiti. That's the end of standing poses. So here we ended with the standing poses and now we are going to do this sitting ones. So you have to be up, up on the with the mat. It's after standing, one has to, that means why first the standing is taken so that you create, as I said, mobility, flexibility, and some understanding regarding your own anatomical body. Then we come to the sitting posture. When you sit in dandasana, you can spread your mat. You know, after knowing the art of standing, one has to know the art of sitting. It's an art. To stand is also an art and to sit is also an art. And dandasana, the one which they are doing, is a basic posture for the sitting asanas. As the tadasana, you saw standing stage, samasthiti is for the standing asanas. So one learns to stretch the legs in a proper way, since the legs do not bear any weight in this posture. That's sitting, there is no weight on the legs, and they learn to stretch the legs. You may say, why am I explaining this? As it's difficult just to know. But this posture, when you see as dandasana, may be just simple for you when you have no problem. But those who have knee problem, those who have crooked knees, the knees because of the arthritis, they have turned out, or ankle, when the swelling is there on the ankles, swelling in the toes, for them, this great. I mean, this is a pose which relieves them from the pain. So, those who have no problems, for them it looks, seems to be very simple. Those who have problems, they know that even to stretch that leg or to keep the back of the knee downward with extension, how difficult it is. When the hands are on the sides, you find the spine getting extended. That means those who can't lift their spine upward, they can learn to lift the spine with that force of the hand. This gives a sort of symmetrical extension to both the sides of the spine. Because your hands are down, you can bring the alignment on both the sides. You can use the pressure on the arm to lift your chest, lift your spine, open your armpits, etc. And it makes not only that giving the correction, but it gives firmness to the spine. It makes the spine straight, giving exact fulcrum, so that one sits on the exact point of the seat. That means you are sitting, but at the same time, you have to sit in such a manner as though you are not sitting. That means, you people are sitting there. You are absolutely flat there on the mat. But they are not sitting in that manner. They have to be sharp on their buttocks. You understand that is because otherwise you will say that you are always sitting. But in your sitting posture, you drop yourself so much that your blood circulation is restricted to some extent. Whereas here, they are exactly on that buttock bone point, so that no part of the flesh is dropped down and that's why they don't find any kind of load or heaviness coming on their buttock region. And when they are to sit in this manner, you find their spine has to be lifted right from the sacrum, the lumbar, the dorsal and the cervical, that means base of the spine, middle waistline spine, the spine of the chest, the spine of the neck, and that's how they have to sit in the erect position. Any drooping or any shoulder dropping in your chest exercise is not allowed. You know, Lord Patanjali and Lord Krishna both, that means in Bhagavad Gita and also Yoga Sutras, you find they have never permitted us to sit with a propped trunk. We are supposed to sit in a straight position for the meditation. And therefore, for us, for the practitioners of yoga, this becomes very essential to remove the defects in our sitting by doing dandasana. The knee. Almost all of you ask about the knee, but you don't worry about the spine. Because all of you want to think, if you can just sit with a cross leg and close your eyes, your meditation begins. That means you sit with simple swastikasana, folded leg, cross leg or whatever you do, and you close your eyes, so you are only connected from the lower part of the body to the head. In between you are forgetting. You understand? This is, you are not bothered at all, whether your spine, your heart, your chest, in which way it is functioning, or in which way it has to be positioned during the meditation. Whereas this is the one which is teaching you that which way you have to lift the spine, which way you have to keep your body, so that it's erected at the same time, it's so much free that these parts of the body does not keep on bothering you when you are meditating. And unfortunately, we just don't need people, those who do meditation, they say, how to sit with, we can't bend the knee, teach us, so that we can do Padmasana and we can meditate. And second question they ask, tell us how to close the eyes so that we can meditate. That means you think for meditation only two things are required. One, sitting in Padmasana or sitting in folded leg, and another thing, closing the eyes. And also there is nothing in between the technique. This is how the questions are also asked in a wrong way. Whereas all these are the things which are important if you have to do the meditation. Now you go to the respective poses as you have to do. Now you see the poses like Virasana, Paddhakonasana, Gomukhasana, Swastikasana and Upavishtakonasana. In all these poses you find the knees are bent in different directions. Here is Virasana, then it is Gomukhasana, then it is simple Swastikasana, Rajakshmi is doing Paddhakonasana, and here she is extending her legs in Upavishtakonasana, because this is also a sitting posture, so the knees are not bent, you find the spine is activized. You know, as far as knees are concerned, the wear and tear is faster in that joint because the body weight is on them constantly during walking and standing. You walk and you stand, always as position which we take, and you find the wear and tear there. And whereas these are the poses, even while sitting on the chair also, you may say walking and standing, but while sitting on the chair also, the weight is taken off from the leg because your seat is there on the chair, but the blood circulation is restricted as far as your legs are concerned, and the gravitational pull is there which causes sort of sagging and sinking in the body. And these asanas not only maintain the mobility of the joints but also remove the lactic acid which is stored in the joints, and that is what is poisonous for the joint if the lactic acid is collected in your joints, which causes swelling, etc. And not only that, it strains the joint so much that you can't even move or you can't bear the weight. So these are the postures which help. Now Virasana, Upavishtakonasana and Paddhakonasana. You see, as Virasana, Upavishtakonasana and Paddhakonasana. Because many of you may not be knowing the name, that's why I'm pointing at the poses. First, this is such as gout, rheumatic pains, flat foot, calcaneal spurs, you know, the pain, varicose veins. You find this pose, that pose, even Upavishtakonasana helping, since the extension is so much that the blood flow, circulation is easier in those poses. Now those sort of who suffer with vomiting, nausea, heaviness, especially after meals, that means after having food, will be benefited if they just do these postures immediately after. May not take the arms upward as Vijay is just sitting, or Virasana especially where the spine is lifted, you find the space is created between the pelvic and the floating rib, and the organic body receives in that state, and that's why even after the meals one can do. Paddhakonasana, Rajakshmi is doing there, is a boon for those who suffer with urinary disorders, kidney infection, swelling in the prostate glands, heaviness in testicles and sciatica. Paddhakonasana also same way it is effective on the generative organs. Check the irregular flow or excessive bleeding during menstrual periods. They stimulate ovaries, and that's how they work on the reproductive organs. Now all these asanas, except this Gomukhasana of course, which Abhay is doing, are suitable for pregnant women, for healthy pregnancy and easy delivery. And you see all these poses are good except that one where he crosses the leg. And the arm, of course, if I have to speak about the arm movement, Gomukhasana, now take the hands upward, Parvatasana for you. You see arm extension there, you change the leg position away. And here also Parvatasana, you see in Virasana. So you can do Parvatasana in Virasana, Parvatasana in Swastikasana, and Gomukhasana, the hand adjustment. That's an arm work, which not only lubricates the arm and the shoulder joint, but also develops the chest muscles, the extension. Therefore, arm work is emphasized. those who suffer with asthma, arthritis and rheumatism. They are made to stand and extend the leg, since that extension comes from the pelvic region. And when they sit and do, it comes more from the pectoral region. That is one extension right from the bottom you are standing, and one extension from the armpit level more, so that both the sides are, both parts of the body are activized in a proper way. So it may seem just stretching of the arm, but one action originates in standing poses from the pelvic region, and the other originates in sitting posture from the pectoral region. Now in all these sitting asanas, one learns to lift the spine upward against the gravity and postpones the aging of the spine, which often gets dropped as the aging begins. Virasana, Baddha Konasana and Swastikasana are helpful. You find these Swastikasana, Virasana and Baddha Konasana. They are helpful in the practice of pranayama. That means even for the later pranayamic practice, the beginner is already putting a foundation there with proper sitting. And all these sitting asanas counterbalance the exertion of standing asana. That's how after standing asana you come to the sitting asana. So we can release. And now let us switch over to the next. The forward extension of the spine, so whosoever has to be on the platform be there. All of you sit in the dasana. So after sitting, we proceed for the forward extension. You have to come for Paschimottanasana, Dhanushirasana, Triangulai Path Paschimottanasana, Marichasana, Upavishtukasana, take your mats and be seated. All of you sit in Dandasana. Spread your mats if you want to. You saw that first for the forward extension, the sitting position has to be adjusted, so first they are sitting in Dandasana. And also you saw in previous position like Gomukhasana, Virasana, Swastikasana, the sufficient mobility was created in the knees while doing the sitting asana. That means you have learned to bend your knees. It's a time to proceed now towards the forward extension when the knee also has to help you to go forward. So the forward bending can be improved, as I said, previous action you saw. Pashvottanasana, Uttanasana, Prasarika Paduttanasana, Padakushthasana and Adhomukhasvanasana. Those will be standing forward extension. The sitting postures you saw where you improve your knee movement, like bending the knee in Virasana, bending the knee in Swastikasana, extending the legs in Upavishtukonasana in the previous action. Those asanas, they help you to proceed with the forward bend. Now go to the proper positions like Dhanushirasana, Triangle, Marichasana, there you see Upavishtukonasana action. Here, first sit just with bent leg and sit in simple Dandasana with bent leg. Abhay, you also bring your hands back. Abhay is in Paschimottanasana. Vijay is doing Janushishasana there, his right leg is bent. Rajalakshmi at that end is doing sitting for the Upavishtukonasana. Here you find Megha doing getting ready herself for Triangle Mukhai Path Paschimottanasana. Devaki is getting ready herself for Marichasana. The knee movement you find different in all these forward extension. The first one, you have to see in this knee, the first, like Abhay is sitting in the center posture, in Dandasana, then there is Dhanushirasana, Triangle here, then Marichasana here, and Upavishtha. That's how the sequence of forward bends are. Then, after sitting or properly bending the knee, next pose is that they have to hold the feet and make the back concave. Whereas Devaki takes her hands back, she holds the wrist at the back, which you learnt which in Pashvottanasana. And now you raise your head upward, they make the back concave. Now after raising their back from the sacrum region, they have to exert, that means that's concave back, then they should go down with the head down. Now these asanas, when they go take the head down, basically make the brain and the heart to be in a restful state. They stop the inner agitation by soothing the nerves and calming the mind. That's why in patient's class, when they are having some blood pressure problem, etc., we say use a blanket there on the shin bone and rest your forehead so that their spine is extended in line with the neck. They can elongate their spine and they can remain in the restful state. widening of the brain, widening of the mind, soothing the nerves, etc. On the other side, till they are bending forward, you find they stimulate the digestive system, they tone the abdominal organs, and keep them free from sluggishness. The dullness is removed. Therefore, it is essential to have a regular practice of these asanas by those who suffer from acidity, flatulence, vomit, indigestion, and other, any other problems concerned with digestion. That means one side, you are improving your heart, brain, which is always taxed to a great extent in human being, and other side, the digestive system, that's also taxed because of our wrong way of taking food, like eating heavily, eating very much less, undernourished, more nourished, I mean overnourished, etc. All these problems one can solve with this problem. These asanas improve the blood circulation in the pelvic region and help adrenals, gonads, ovaries to function in a healthy way. That means, again, it's a question of reproductive system which can be kept in a healthy state. So women can do all these postures, because we often, those who join the beginner's class, they come and ask me, especially when a male teacher is there teaching, they are shy to ask the teacher what to do when they are having the periods. During the menstruation, all these postures can be done without any fear, so that they can get rid of their menstrual problems and regularize their menstrual flow. They can change the side. Change the side and accept Abhay, who has to go on the same side. Because often Paschim Tanasana means they say, now other side means they get confused. That now other side will be confused. Those who suffer from high blood pressure, because these are common problems, because of these days, what called sort of light, the hasty work and sort of thing, suffer from high blood pressure, hypertension, anxiety, like stress and because of stress and strain, short temper, restlessness, insomnia, headache, migraine, myopia and glaucoma of the eyes, anemia, easy fatigue, weakness, low fever, continuous low fever are benefited by doing these asanas. The forward extensions tone the liver, spleen, pancreas and activate kidneys. Janushi Shasana, Upavishta Konasana, check. You see the Upavishtakonasana there, they check enlargement, that is Janushirasana and that one. Enlargement of prostate glands, which is very common with men after certain age. Triyanga Mukhekapatpashchimottanasana, that is this pose what she is doing here, Megha, helps those who suffer with dropped arches, flat feet, sprain, stiffness in the ankles, lock in the knees and swelling in the legs. Marichasana, which Devaki is doing, works on the shoulders, armpits, as one holds the arms back. And Paschimottanasana, what Abhay is doing, massages the heart, rests and refreshes the mind and removes the exertion and increases the endurance. Now all of you in Paschimottanasana. All of you. You know, in syllabus, according to the syllabus, Paschimottanasana should be taught first. That means when Guruji is giving the program for that, for every 2 weeks, Guruji says, well, he introduces Paschimottanasana somewhere in the beginning, and then the forward bend extensions are introduced later after 4th week or 6th week or 8th week, etc. So Paschimottanasana is taught first before the other forward extensions, in order to bring the symmetrical extension of the spinal muscles of both the sides. You understand? Because now both the legs are straight and they have to extend. And the previous extension, they show what you did in the previous seat on side, previous poses. In here, in these poses you find, you have to move from one side of the spine. That means, if, as Devaki is doing, for her, it's easier for the left side to move, the right is difficult. Because hand is, leg is holding her spine back. Then the knee is bent, so the right side spine is bent back. In this case, Vijay's case, right knee is bent, so right side spine goes back. A beginner does not understand this. That's why they are given paschimottanasana. Now do paschimottanasana. So a symmetrical extension is developed, and then these asanas are introduced further as a step. Though this paschimottanasana